common lecture of CVSB 203. Before I get started, I want to just make a couple of comments. As some of you may know, the Ministry of Education announced that Tuesday the 14th is a holiday. We have scheduled, if you look on the website for the course, there is scheduled a lecture by Jonathan Norton on that day, or Joshua Norton, and it is being postponed until the 21st, so that will soon be updated on the calendar. Second, I'm going to go through, so this second lecture, the goal of this lecture is to introduce you, as all the common lectures are, to introduce you to the texts and some of the major themes in each block of texts. So in this lecture, we enter into the second block of texts, which concern the scientific revolution. There will be a little bit of a change of scenery today after 30 minutes. Nadia Bouali will come up and deliver the final part of the lecture for 20 minutes. So when I start to wrap up, don't get out of your seats and start walking away. There will be more, okay? So what I will talk about are two of the two primary texts, the first two primary texts in this reading for this week, which are by Francis Bacon and René Descartes. And essentially what I'm going to do is give you a compare and contrast of those two texts and those two writers. Now, we're talking about, in this section, the scientific revolution. I'm not going to take you through all the developments of the scientific revolution. We've seen some of those in Copernicus. In the next lecture by Joshua Norton, you'll also see other of those. But as the background for what we're talking about today, I want to remind you of some of those things, because the texts that we are reading are not the first texts in the scientific revolution. In fact, if you try to find out when the scientific revolution began, you get various dates going all the way back to the late 1200s, some people say, right? If any of you have read The Name of the Rose, there's a priest in the 14th century who is essentially an early modern scientist doing Sherlock Holmes detective work, right? So there's all kinds of discussions about when this began, because early modern science didn't begin with a big theoretic moment where someone announced a new idea of what science was. Things slowly changed, and they became changed more quickly until suddenly there was an explosion of changes and developments in knowledge and technology, to the point where people had to turn their reflection onto it and decide, what is this that's going on with the human race in Europe at this time? And the two texts that we're reading by Descartes and Bacon are among the very first attempts to look back at what the scientific revolution has been doing and will be doing, and to try to give an interpretation of it and a defense of it. That's why my lecture is in fact called The Scientific Revolution, Its Meaning and Its Justification. So both of these texts are philosophical, scientific tracts about science. They don't contribute directly to science. Now, what are some of those developments, just to flash in your mind? And as I said, next lecture, Josh Norton will say more about the implements of science. But just looking at some of the major works, of course, we looked at Copernicus's work published in 1543 that profoundly changed the way people looked at the universe. But at the same time, you had all kinds of different publications and discoveries, right? Among these are, just to go through them kind of briefly, Galileo published a work in 1610 called The Starry Messenger, and that was the first work in which a human being recorded what they saw when they turned a telescope to the skies. And so you can see these are his own drawings here of the moon, and he was the first person to suppose and to defend the idea that the moon is not a smooth, perfectly smooth surface, which is what they thought before, because it was made of some other material, right? It wasn't made out of rocks and things. And as he looked closely at the moon, he saw ridges and things you cannot see with the naked eye, and he argued these were like craters, like what we believe now. And he drew these pictures, and people didn't particularly believe him. But very importantly, in this same work, he discovered the moons of Jupiter and other things in 1610. So these are some of the empirical things that come about. Kepler publishes works on the optics of telescopes. This is as important as work in, you know, as Copernicus's work, because it's through the instruments that these scientific theories get some kind of backing and take some foothold, right? So there was major breakthroughs in this period in optics. Once the telescope was designed, there were Lots of publications about better designs of telescopes, the discovery of the reflective telescope, and all these kinds of things. So that's all in astronomy. If you look here, this was a major work prior to Bacon by a guy named William Gilbert on the magnet. You see him, I put this here particularly because he's mentioned in your reading several times. If you open this book, he built himself a small Earth that was magnetic and tried to show that the way compass needles worked and things must attest to the fact that the Earth is a large magnet. And he did all kinds of pioneering work, and he is considered one of the greatest and first experimental physicists. And the theory of magnetism that any of you learn in physics is first built upon the work of Gilbert. Interestingly, you'll see that Bacon thinks Gilbert is full of hogwash, right? And that he's one of those bad empiricists, as he's called in the text. But very important. In addition, chemistry was quite slow compared to astronomy and other areas because it's so complex, but you had all kinds of corpuscular and theories of atoms and things and experiments where people were separating out materials and starting to bring chemistry away from things like alchemy, pseudoscience, and starting to really understand some of the basic rules and laws that chemicals and atoms obeyed. Also, the human body. Vesalius, I'm sure you've all heard of Vesalius, was the first person to do these kind of, this is a picture, he's hung a skeleton here and he's stripped the skin off and he's showing you all of the different parts. Previous to this, most of the work was done on animals to understand how the body worked. So there was very little work on the human body itself. And this was quickly followed by Harvey's discussion of the circulation of the blood and the motion of the heart, which was revolutionary in medicine. So all kinds of things are going on. And what happens, so this is the kind of the data that people like Bacon and Descartes are presented with. These are the kinds of developments. And now their question is, what made all of this possible? What does it mean? And particularly, how can we justify and explain the progress that clearly is being made in various publications like this? How can we defend that against, for instance, the Aristotelian theory or the theories of the church or whatnot? Now, this background leads, so given this data, Bacon and Descartes separate themselves kind of into two ways of looking at that scientific revolution. So they have the same information before them, same kind of developments, and they each come to almost diametrically opposed views of the meaning of science and why science is true and the method of science. You would think it wouldn't be so difficult, right? You would think you could look into those texts and see how were people thinking and discover from that how people should think in the future to figure out what science is, right? But that is not so easy. And we'll see Bacon and Descartes come up with very different theories of what scientific method is about and what it means and where it fits into human life. Now, on this slide, you can see I've called these kind of two traditions, and I've used a small T here, not a big T. It's not traditions as a big T. Descartes and Bacon certainly, and their followers, saw them in some ways as opposed to each other. But these are not kind of traditions in the sense that Bacon founded a tradition. Many people regard Gilbert, as I mentioned, in the magnet, as part of the Baconian tradition. But Gilbert preceded Bacon, and Bacon thought Gilbert was doing something completely different than what Bacon supposed. So these are not hard and fast distinctions between these traditions, in other words. There's a lot of mixing and back and forth. And so somewhat the picture I'm going to draw here will be a bit of a caricature, but it's an illuminating caricature. Right? So I'm just going to go back and forth between these two traditions, right, and the points. So the Baconian tradition if you look in the literature, you sometimes see it called the empiricist tradition. But take that with a grain of salt. As you're reading the text, Bacon will claim he is not an empiricist. He has great problems with empiricism, or the belief that all truth originates in the senses, as we'll see. But it's better to call his tradition the experimental inductive tradition, and that's what I'll call it in the next few slides. It's experimental, it focuses on experiments and on the eliciting of principles and axioms of the operations, the way in which bodies operate and interact with each other through experimentation. And we'll see more of that. It's also inductive. I'm sure you all know what induction is. Some of you know? Someone have an idea what induction is? No one wants to speak up. So induction, generally, there was a previous idea of induction. Bacon didn't invent induction. Already in Aristotle, the idea that we look at experience, and by seeing lots of different experiences and comparing them, we come to some general rules. You know, you see the ball drop, and the ball drop, and the ball drop, and you say, something makes the ball drop, and balls do drop in general, right? This is kind of the induction that children do. Bacon's idea is that this is how science must proceed. It must not begin with general rules and principles. It must start with induction, and it must focus itself on complex induction, not simple induction. You don't just drop the ball over and over again. You drop the ball in different circumstances. You compare dropping a metal ball with a wooden ball, and you compare and contrast, and you write all these down in tables. This is the essence of the Baconian method, right? Collecting all this data, and then from that, trying to gain some kind of general ideas that you can use in the future to anticipate what is going to happen. Right? So that's the experimental inductive method, and many of you recognize we use this in science today. Yeah. The Cartesian tradition is better described as something like what I call the mathematical deductive tradition. So at the center of this, so all of you have probably done some geometry in your life, and you start with the axioms, you know, definitions of lines and points and triangles, and you have all those things at the top of your page, and then you add them to each other and construct things, and you deduce, not induce, you deduce conclusions that follow from the truth of those premises, right? Deductive logic. This tradition, instead of looking for those first principles, thinks it can arrive at those first principles almost immediately, if it has the right method, and then to deduce all further truths. So it's not going to compare different weights of you know, different types of balls to see how they fall or whatnot. It will first try to arrive at the universal laws of motion of bodies, and then it doesn't have to look at, supposedly, wooden balls and lead balls and different things to find out what's going to happen. It can already deduce that what must happen based upon those universal principles. Now, that model both of reasoning and the model that is applied to the world is a mathematical one. Right, so it's mathematical deductive, and we'll see the justification for that in Descartes. So if you were to describe that more generally, you could say that the experimental inductive method, and I'm talking about here, it moves from experiences we have towards what are called principles, right? And it moves from things that are last in nature or effects to trying to understand the laws of their causes. Right, it moves from the complex things we find in the world and breaks them down analytically into the simple things we find in the world around us. It has a kind of regressive method. It goes back to the beginnings. The deductive method, it starts from those principles. It doesn't go back to those principles, right? It wants to start with the principles and go from there to explaining experience. So it moves in the opposite direction in the way it thinks. It goes from causes to effects. It goes from simple things to complex things, right? And it is progressive. And as I said, you probably recognize the Baconian method as scientific in our modern sense. But if you are thinking about things like astrophysics or cosmology or quantum theory, this is almost certainly much more like what you think physics is going to be like, right? People don't go into quantum theory and do all kinds of experiments before they come up with their theories. They come up with their theories and then they look for experiments. Right? So this, too, is part of the modern way we do science. Now, just some representatives, Gilbert, Bacon, Vesalius, Boyle, people who are into description and analysis. And on the other side, people who fall into this tradition roughly are Descartes, Copernicus, Kepler, Galileo, Leibniz, von Schirnhausen. Newton, if you were to look at Newton later, he's quite a bit later than these two traditions. He tries to blend them together, and that's our modern science tries to blend them together and bring them in balance to some extent. In their opposition to Aristotle, so all the modern period as we've seen or we've talked about, there's this opposition to the ancient theories of Aristotle and the theories of the church, which were Aristotelian. Not surprisingly, given their orientations, the Baconian tradition tends to argue with Aristotle and say that he's too speculative and too theoretical, and you'll see that although he does some induction, Bacon admits, his induction flies over experience and goes straight to the first principles. And so Bacon sees Aristotle as belonging to this kind of a camp, right, who are all wrong because they've got the wrong method. On the other side, not surprisingly, the Cartesians tend to see Aristotle as too empirical, as too focused on experience. And if you read Galileo's work, he has these dialogues in which he tries to present his new world system, the Copernican world system. And the Aristotelians there are constantly saying, but wait, we don't feel like we're moving, right? You say we're moving through the sky around the sun at amazing speeds, but look, sense data is the only secure thing we have, says Aristotle. And he did say that. So they paint the Aristotelians as not able to make the flights of fancy and mathematical abstraction to reach the truth. Right, so Aristotle gets battered around for completely different reasons by these two traditions. Not surprisingly, the Baconian tradition, it does distrust the senses, and we'll see why that is. But most of all, the unaided intellect. The intellect is full of tendencies to go into error, and that's why they see these kind of theoretical approaches to the world as fundamentally wrong, because there's no good check on them. They tend to fly towards first principles that are in fact the expressions of individuals' peculiarities of mind and their cultures and these kinds of things. And they don't have experience as that test to fight against their own prejudices. The Cartesian tradition, by contrast, does not see truth as originating in the senses at all. All truth truly originates in the mind, in the intellect, in the same thing that Bacon rejected as the source of truth. And the unaided intellect, which for Bacon is the source of all our errors, for Descartes is regarded as the only secure foundation of truth. We'll see more why that is or how he tries to explain that. So going a little bit further into these, as I said earlier, the Baconian tradition focuses on the design of experiments and the methodological comparison and sifting of results and in the production of technology. If any of you get to read or have assigned to read, as you will in my class, Bacon's New Atlantis, you will see that the world he envisions of science is one, it's kind of this amazing world where everything is about displaying the new technological inventions that have come about. So they have whole places for displaying ways of deluding the senses. So it's like a fun house, right? This is part of scientific institutions because you have to study how the senses are. So this, I suppose, be full of mirrors and all kinds of things and all kinds of ways of producing weird animals. He talks about if you've watched the news recently, they've been able to put breed humans with pigs. In China, they've done this. These kinds of ideas are, if you read the Bacon text, he's talking about turning all kinds of animals into each other and breeding them with each other, but not breeding them physically, but through some kind of way of making their seeds go together. And you'll see he has no idea what he's talking about, of course, Bacon. But now, scientifically, these things have come about. So you'll if you read this, it's very interesting. But that technology, the idea of science is all about technology and producing effects. Descartes, on the other hand, or his tradition, they focus on the analysis of pure concepts and mathematical techniques and theory building. Descartes, in the beginning of his work that you'll be reading, says that the fruits, the effects, the technology that comes out of science comes at the very end of the thing. Bacon wants the technology should come at the beginning. It's the proof that you're on the right track. Whereas Descartes wants you to follow the track all the way to the end and eventually start to produce things out of it. It's quite secondary. Bacon says almost nothing about mathematics. He, in fact, rejected the Copernican theory and called it a lot of mathematical cleverness, much like the Aristotelians did. On the other hand, of course, for the Cartesian tradition that follows in the wake of Copernicus, mathematics is the key. Copernicus himself said that you cannot understand my work if you don't see the universe through the eyes of a mathematician. And this is in the same tradition as Galileo, who said that if you open the book of nature, you will find that it is written in the language of mathematics, namely in triangles and circles and squares. So nature is essentially and profoundly mathematical, geometrical for them. So mathematics is the key to all science. Let's see, as following from this, the Baconian tradition tended to reject the Copernican theories and were not particularly interested in astronomy, which is all mathematical. As I said, Bacon thinks the Copernican theory is kind of ridiculous, and he goes back to a kind of theory where the Earth is in the middle of the universe, and everything gets lighter and more fiery as you go out, kind of a strange theory. There are some exceptions here. Gilbert was a big Copernican before, so there are some exceptions there. The Cartesian tradition saw, really at the beginning, no problem with the relationship between religion and science. And you'll see this in the New Atlantis that he wrote, this kind of, it's an idealistic description of a world that is both profoundly Christian and supposed to be profoundly natural and scientific at the same time. He doesn't present there as being any kind of problems. Of course, in this tradition, there will eventually be problems because you think someone like Darwin is part of this kind of Baconian tradition. And eventually, there were major problems. But at the beginning, there doesn't seem to be, because Bacon does not lead us to a new theory of the universe like Descartes does. He doesn't want to replace Aristotle in that sense by presenting a whole new worldview or embracing the Copernican theory. So he wants to produce technology, and what can the church possibly say against innovations of technology, right? So the Cartesian tradition, by contrast, found, and this is important for what I'll say in the remainder of this lecture, it was profoundly formed by the condemnation of Galileo in 1623. This was this is the background to all of Descartes' work. In fact, Descartes himself was an early modern scientist and had written nothing in philosophy until the condemnation of Galileo. And he tells us himself in another work that he wrote that when that happened, he retreated because he decided not to publish his scientific works. And then he realized he needed to justify the whole method of science that he was doing. And so he went back to philosophy, metaphysics, to try to give a new justification of the mathematical theory of the universe. All right, so Galileo's condemnation is absolutely key. Of course, Galileo was condemned for something, for the Copernican theory, which Bacon rejected. So this other tradition doesn't see that as particularly significant. So a little bit more and some quotes, taking us into this Baconian experimental inductive method, right? So roughly, the experimental method aims at eliciting first principles or causes from a methodological explanation of experience and experiments. So here's a representative quote from Bacon. He writes, "We regard induction as the form of demonstration which respects the senses, stays close to nature, and fosters results, works, fruits, technology. By our method, axioms are gradually elicited step by step so that we reach our general axioms only at the very end." In fact, later in the work, when Bacon talks about the great instauration, this new project he has of carrying out the sciences, the very last part is where these take place. And he says, this is not something I can do or will be done in my lifetime. Right? So the drawing of those general axioms is put off into the very distant future. In other words, it's not the focus. The focus is on the experimentation and the refinement, not the jump to first principles. So to continue, what the sciences need is a form of induction which takes experience apart and analyzes it and forms necessary conclusions on the basis of appropriate exclusions and rejections. As for the first notions of the intellect, the first most primary ideas we have in our minds, we'll see those are important for Descartes. Not one by itself escapes our suspicion, and we do not confirm them without submitting them to a new trial and a verdict given in accordance with it. Right? That sounds very much like what, if you look up the word empiricism, what that means. But it's important that Bacon is not, he says he's not an empiricist. He accuses others of being empiricists. And this is why. So I say he's not an empiricist. Look at these quotes. He says, but the greatest obstacle and distortion of the human understanding comes from the dullness, the limitations, and deceptions of the senses. All right? And again, and yet every interpretation of nature which has a chance to be true is achieved by instances and suitable and relevant experiments in which the senses only give a judgment on the experiment, while the experiment judgment on the nature and the thing itself. So from this, you can gather a slightly more accurate idea of what he has in mind. He, too, believes that the senses deceive us, that the senses, when we sense things, we tend to mix our, what's happening when you, he says that we sense things after the analogy of human nature and not the thing. When we sense things in the mode that human beings sense them. Our nature is somewhat mixed in the image of what we sense. And so the senses are deceptive. However, the senses, unlike the intellect, are closer to the objects that we're actually studying. And so what we need to primarily focus on is taking that data of the senses and removing those aberrations. Right? So the senses, they are the way to truth, but by themselves, unaided, do not lead to truth. So what we need are experiments. Experiments are how we correct our senses. Now, that's what he means in this last part. So the senses, you can say, scientists today, when they go into the laboratory, they don't perceive things and write down what they perceive. They use experiments. And of course, the senses tell them what the experiments say. They, you know, they look on the dials and the senses tell us what the experiment says, right? But the experiments themselves are what determine what sense data is important and what is not, and what is true and what is not. So that's why he says the experiment gives the judgment on the nature, on nature and the thing itself. Well, the senses only judge the experiment. They only tell us its results. Okay, so let's contrast this for a moment with the mathematical deductive method, which is characteristic of the Cartesian tradition. It aims, and Descartes is probably the greatest representative of this model, the purest form of it. It aims at a closed system of first principles that are guaranteed by a method from which all other truths can be logically deduced. So he says in the work that you'll be reading that he has enumerated all the principles that are needed to explain anything that happens in nature or that will ever be discovered in nature. He makes this major claim. You can see it comes from his method. His idea is we have to start at the principles. And so we can't be certain of anything that comes later unless we enumerate and understand all the first principles of things from which we'll deduce them, right? So here are some quotes that capture this idea from the text by Descartes, The Principles of Philosophy. He says, quote, but the supreme good considered by natural reason without the light of faith is nothing more than the knowledge of truth through its first causes. In other words, the wisdom of which philosophy is the study. So it's the knowledge of things through its first causes, namely knowing things deductively through the first principles that are the reasons for them. That's the goal of philosophy and its focus. Quote, the true principles by which we reach the highest degree of wisdom wherein consists the sovereign good of human life are those I've proposed in this work. And two considerations alone are sufficient to establish this. The first of which is that these are very clear, and the second, that we can deduce all other truths from them. So in essence, the Cartesian method here, the idea of, we'll see how he guarantees the truth of things, is extremely simple. He says, these things all must be true because they are clear and understood by the mind without experiments, unaided, right? These first principles are understood, and we can deduce everything else from them. And that's all that is required to guarantee the truth of the first principles that we use. You can think of Bacon, back to Bacon. He would see in this the height of the wrong method, right? The exact opposite of what he wants us to do. And yet both Bacon and Descartes are responding to the same developments of early modern science and seeing it in a completely opposite ways. Finally, another quote, it is unnecessary to seek any other principles than I have given in order to arrive at the most exalted knowledge of which the mind of man is capable. Unlike Bacon, who puts finding those first principles off into some future generation, Descartes says, I have them all here right now, and this is the beginning. What lies to future generations is deriving the consequences, not arriving at new knowledge. So the second aspect of this mathematical deductive method is that these principles are themselves mathematical, or are analogous to mathematical ideas and their connections. So here's a quote. So the idea here is that all of these first principles, if you wonder how is it possible to derive logically all the consequences in nature from the first principles, it's because the world itself is a kind of geometrical construct. And once you understand the first principles of geometry and some of the first principles of physics, like the laws of inertia, things you will recognize, then he thinks you can derive everything else logically, axiomatically. Okay, just give me a minute. So these principles, here's a quote, the nature of matter or body, considered in general, does not consist in its being hard or ponderous or colored, or for that matter, or that which affects our senses in any other way, but simply in its being a substance extended in length, breadth, and depth. As I understand it, it's time for me to give up the floor to Nadia, so I will post the rest of my slides on the website for your interest. And they just develop further some of the points that I made here. So thank you.
So what I'm going to try to do in the remaining 20 minutes is engage with the text that you have for this reading for the theme for this week, which is Margaret Cavendish's The Description of a New World Called the Blazing World. And I suppose what I'm going to try to do is come at the theme from a bit of a different angle, to try and see how the ideas about the natural world and the human and the scientific revolution had an impact on questions that have to do with political authority, okay? So Margaret Cavendish, or as she was called, Mad Madge of Newcastle, we'll come to see why with her crazy idea about the constitution of the world, writes this description of a new world called the Blazing World in 1668. And at this time, you know, England was in this moment of turbulent political upheaval. The English Civil War was ongoing, the execution of King Charles I, Cromwellian rule was instated, and then there was a subsequent restoration of the monarchy. So in her time, in Margaret Cavendish's time, the concept of revolution was yet indissociable from civil war. And this is something perhaps my class we've already brought up in our discussion. So the concept of revolution was still implicated in a perception of history as a cycle of repetition of the same, a return to the point of origin. And although Cavendish was a royalist, so she was a supporter of the king, a supporter of the monarchy, she thought that the task of political philosophy, which she draws out in this phantasmatic blazing world that you're going to be look at, ought to be providing answers for how the Commonwealth, an idea that we will also encounter in a couple of weeks with Thomas Hobbes, could best avoid the dangers of faction and social strife. So her defense of the monarchy, as you will see in the blazing world, came through the adoption of an idea of a commonwealth. A commonwealth or a body politic seen as a unity of parts in which centralized absolutism is somehow dispersed into all the bodies of the citizens. And I want to try and show some parallels between this understanding of the commonwealth and her understanding of the natural world, which is what I'm calling this kind of, you know, absurd vitalism, this crazy vitalism. In parallel to seeing the Commonwealth as this whole constituted by parts, Cavendish saw the natural world also as one that is constituted by this uniform matter that is equally dispersed among parts, self-moving, having will and autonomy. So she has this idea of self-moving, willful matter that constitutes nature. So matter, in Cavendish's view, is like the members of the Commonwealth. It has rational, sensitive, and inanimate traits. So the sovereignty of the monarch is somehow now displaced into the sovereignty of individual elements in society. The body of the king is somehow split up, divided, and distributed to the members of the Commonwealth, And it is only by giving sovereignty to the individual elements, these different citizens of the commonwealth, whether in nature or in society, that sovereignty is somehow reinstated in the blazing world. And this is a very interesting, very interesting shift that happens. So the fantasy, what I'm calling this kind of the fantasy of the blazing world that you will be reading in the coming weeks, is constructed as one in which the task of conquering the world, and she will say this very clearly, is carried out through an authority that doesn't function through brute force, through territorial control, but then one that kind of runs very deep into our very understanding of the nature of the human and the non-human. And this possibility that Cavendish constructs in The Blazing World, she says, causes her a great source of delight, and I quote her, "In the formation of those worlds, these imaginary worlds, I take more delight and glory than ever Alexander or Caesar did conquering this terrestrial world." This is Cavendish. So in the Blazing World, you will find this fantasy of another world that is erected in order to weave an early form of what I'm suggesting is a liberal republicanism, very early on, that Cavendish was somehow arguing was necessary for the restoration of sovereignty in this kind of moment of the crisis of the monarchy that she's living in, she's living through in England. So she somehow exposes to us in this blazing world that political authority can only be legitimated through a fantasy in which everyone in society has to partake. A fantasy by which the monarch's authority is derived from a mass of people who have this kind of self-sufficient equal reason amongst them. So the utopia that Cavendish constructs is one in which monarchical rule can only achieve its goal, not simply through the exercise of a brute monopoly of force, as Thomas Hobbes would somehow suggest later on in the course, but one in which a particular set of values has to be promoted for the people to remain faithful subjects to the king. And this, for this Cavendish, you'll see, adopts this kind of Renaissance idea of virtue, this kind of Renaissance idea of virtue that is revived in the Renaissance, in which the love of the people, rather than hate and fear, love and admiration, is what needs to be cultivated as the grounds for political authority, as the grounds for sovereignty. So The Blazing World is a story about an estranged young lady who ultimately saves the monarchy in both her phantasmic world and the real world after, only after constructing or putting into experimenting with her idea about how political authority needs to function in the blazing world, does this young lady go back to the real world and save the monarchy, save the empire through the example that she'd already put to work in her blazing world. And so the girl survives being kidnapped by this avaricious merchant who lacks knowledge in the sciences and leads himself to shipwreck. She ends up being rescued only in order to save this other empire that she's going to be taken to. And you'll see in the Blazing World, it's very interesting how Cavendish argues for the importance of the ceremonial and the religious. Anti the Protestants and other anti-royalists would have it at the time. She believed that although somehow there's a minimal level of religious conformity that should be necessary for civil peace, religious difference ought to still be allowed, and you will see this in the discussion at the beginning of The Blazing World and her discussion about religion. However, she suggests that the church and the monarch cannot in any way afford to ignore ceremony and ritual. That's why you'll see these dazzling magical displays used by the Empress in The Blazing World. They're all meant to inspire a sort of religious devotion in her subjects. And I think Cavendish somehow illustrates for us this very important shift in political authority or in sovereignty during this moment of the scientific revolution and during this moment of political turmoil. And I read to you a first quote in your on the handout. "Thus the Empress, by art and her own ingenuity, did not only convert the blazing world to her own religion, but kept them in constant belief, without enforcement or bloodshed. For she knew well that belief was a thing not to be forced or repressed upon the people, but to be instilled in their minds by gentle persuasions. And after this manner, she encouraged them also in all other duties and employments. For fear, though it makes people obey, yet it does not last long. nor is it a social means to keep them to their duties as love. And this is, you know, from the beginning, a quote from the beginning of The Blazing World. So Cavendish, you know, to say a bit more about the context within which, you know, she is, and also the influences on her from natural philosophy at the time. As I said, she was a royalist, a defender of the king, but also heavily involved in circles of natural philosophy. Her and her husband had at their dinner table figures frequently like Thomas Hobbes. They corresponded with European mathematicians and scientists like Marin Mersenne. And they, you know, had these discussions with these guests at their table. Another guest was René Descartes, although, you know, Madge says he never said much, he spoke very little. Another guest was Gassendi, the champion of Epicurean atomism. So this is kind of the context within which Cavendish is writing or thinking. And after the defeat of the monarchy, her and her husband were sent into exile as all of the other supporters of the king, as all of the other royalists. And it was during this time that she writes these 11 books that she wrote in exile. She was also the first woman to visit the Royal Society, to be offered a display, to be offered a display of all kinds of curiosities for her attraction. As you will see, this is something that also happens in The Blazing World. The bear men that the Empress meets also offer to entertain her in a similar fashion. So in the Royal Society, she was made to see Boyle's pump that was used to create vacuum, meat dissolved in sulfuric acid, colored liquids mixed together, a magnet used to move iron fillings, and so on and so forth. However, despite her awe with the experimental method or the experimental sciences, Cavendish took issue with the methods of the Royal Society. And she claimed that the methods of dissection and observation were inferior, far inferior to her more speculative style of philosophy. And if you take note at the beginning of the, again, in a certain discussion with the bearmen, the Empress tells them, the Empress wishes on them that they destroy their telescopes. And she tells them, nature has made your sense and reason far more regular than art has your glasses, for they are mere deluders. So this is where you see her skepticism of the experimental method, and she tries to get them to do this. Of course, the bear men resist, and then the Empress somehow accepts that they keep the telescopes only on the condition, and I quote her, that their disputes and quarrels should remain within their schools and cause no friction or disturbances in the state or government. Okay, so everywhere in her, you know, engagement with the natural philosophy, she's also making arguments for a certain understanding of political authority. Okay, so you will see in The Blazing World, this empress arrives in this land where you have these mixes of men and animals, these creatures that she calls forth for deliberation and questioning. The birdmen, the fishmen, the wormmen, the apemen, the spidermen, the licemen, the parrotmen, the jacksawmen, all representing these various fields of science. As you will read, you will see which represents what. And in this position of calling them forth, all of them for deliberation and questioning, the Empress acts out this role of an all-knowing monarch who would dissipate any kind of dissent among the different parts of the body politic. As such, we see, you know, in The Blazing World, this staging, a certain kind of staging of a key problematic for political authority in the light of the rise of the scientific revolution. So if mastery or the position of the master is now displaced to the sciences, how do we save authority and monarchy? And this is precisely the question that Cavendish is trying to answer in her fantasy of the blazing world. And it proves to be quite an impossible task, because she'll come up with this, you know, pretty crazy, you know, understanding of the nature of matter. And I'll come to that in a second. One that she also says has to only be reduced to mere fancy, her solution for the problem. Her contemporaries, of course, called her Mad Madge of Newcastle. And as we know, it is always the mad who expose the inner contradictions of their social realities. So Madge's madness, her search for a political rule safe from dissent, or ultimately somehow safe from politics, pushed her to attempt to construct an account of science that would be adequate for the reconstitution of sovereignty. And this is kind of the core argument that I'm trying to make in the lecture. And I want to get into now her kind of vitalist utopia, this crazy view of matter that she proposes. And, you know, some people still have these ideas today, and I'll just make some references a bit later. So in her writings, she attacks what's called this kind of corpuscularian view of the natural world, which had been put forth during the time, and by which the world is understood as being composed of inanimate material particles. Against this view, Cavendish defended a more vitalist understanding of the world, in which matter was seen as having both animate and inanimate components. Hobbes and the other mechanistic philosophers of the Royal Society believed that the inanimate corpuscles of matter that constitute the physical world were clearly subordinated to and organized ultimately by a single force. And this is very important. The single force for the mechanistic view and for the supporters of the monarchy was an arbitrary deity that could impose on nature and enforce at will an arbitrary set of mechanical laws. For the royalists, there was a definite analogy that was posited between a centralized mechanical universe and a centralized absolutist state. And this is very, you know, this is very important. So in this historical moment and in this kind of mechanistic movement in the mid-century England, there was a staunch commitment to both an idea of an arbitrary god and an arbitrary monarchy, an arbitrary monarch. So the absolutist power that governed the mechanical universe was, one could say, peculiarly monarchic in design. And Madge was responding to the crisis of the monarchy and trying to somehow find a way to argue that would be different from the mechanistic view that she saw to be to no longer have the answers for how to reinstitute sovereignty. So she responds to this in light of the crisis that's facing the monarchy during the Civil War, and she proposes this different form of materialism that can, in one way, be seen as an exaggeration of the corpuscularian view of the natural world. So for her, the world is composed of matter, of atoms and bodies, sure. However, they're not inanimate, but are somehow self-moving matter. And this is where the sci-fi begins, okay? And that's why it becomes necessary. This is why this is basically kind of a sci-fi novel that you'll be reading or story. So she propounded what we would call a vitalist view of nature in which matter is presented as a self-moving force, an abstract and autonomous principle, a self-willing, self-moving force. This is how she understood matter. So, and in a way similar to Hobbes, who you will encounter in the next couple of weeks, she dismisses the idea of immaterial substance. Her universe is monistic. It's made up of infinite and indivisible substances that she would call only matter. And if you read quote 3 in your handout, this is a small poem that she writes. The flame is not so hot as burning coal. The atoms are too weak to take fast hold. The sharpest into firmest bodies fly. But if their strength be small, they quickly die. Or if their number be not great but small, the blunter atoms beat and quench out all. Now, she accepts this view, but she has a problem with it. She has this theory of animate matter, but she does not accept the Hobbesian view that there can be no cause of motion except by a body, as Hobbes would say, contiguous and moved. So her materialism has a dynamic that's similar to but different from Hobbes. And if you read quote number 5, we'll skip quote number 4, this is how she refutes the Hobbesian understanding. She says, the actions of nature are not forced by one part, driving, pressing, shoving another, as a man doth a wheelbarrow or a whip or a horse, nor by reactions, as if men were footballs or cuffs. So motion for Cavendish was understood as not being a consequence of reactions, but of volition, this crazy idea of self-willing, autonomous, self-moving matter. Material bodies can move only when they choose to move. And I want to show how this translates into what I'm calling a liberal, early kind of liberalism. So for her, bodies of matter all possess sense and reason and perception as well. Nature is not only autonomous, but also conscious and purposive, like free-willing and perceptive men and women. So Cavendish's curious version of materialism, of course, at this moment, was utterly dismissed by all her contemporaries, who accused her of what one of them called a hylozoic atheism. Amongst themselves, none of these her contemporaries chose to engage with her at all. And, you know, as a side note, this hylozoism is somehow still present around in various fields in social theory and kind of some strains of analytic philosophy, so like an actor network theory or panpsychic philosophy. But this is, you know, just a side note. So how do things get a bit more complicated with her materialism, or how do these, I want to show how this, the complications in her materialism lead us into a certain political consequence. Because she introduces into a matter this distinction between a material and immaterial component, a raw material substrate on which animate matter works. The animate matter fashions and orchestrates the movements of the inanimate matter. So the nature of motion and the double nature of matter, the animate and the inanimate, is described by Cavendish as this kind of architectural edifice, a house. And motion is not simply a cause and effect relation. It's not about relying on the passing of time, but it's a spatial function. It's an organized structure in which objects move because of an intrinsic, spontaneous set of negotiations, somehow a utopia of correspondences. So this phantasmatic natural philosophy allows for, on the one hand, an infinite variety in nature, which she, you know, you'll see her concocting all these different creatures in the blazing world. It also allows for many degrees of perception and knowledge, and contains an account of the material mind that overturns the view that humans are superior to animals. And that's why you'll see this animal-man mixes consistently in the blazing world, all these combinations that she'll have. Ultimately, somehow, her view seems to suggest that there's a unity between thinking and being, or that there's that being somehow naturally lends itself to thinking, that matter somehow thinks, perceives, reasons, and senses. So for the members of the Royal Society, like Boyle and others, the anomalies of nature, given their view of matter, were explained by the intervention of a punitive deity, God, right? For Cavendish, the anomalies of nature had to do with disagreements amongst parts of matter. So disagreements in one body, she says, are failed acts of perception, okay? Not of corruption, but failed acts that are based on choice, on perception. And I want to kind of try and show how this will lead into her understanding of the function of eliminating social dissent or social strife. So any kind of antagonism will now be understood as a difference in perception, okay? And this is why I say there's a bit of a beginning kind of sense of liberalism in Cavendish's works. If we move to code 6 in your handout. What, said the Empress, can any mortal be a creator? Yes, answered the spirits. So that's why, of course, I'm saying that her view of matter is somewhat atheistic, right? So there is no punitive deity. There's a disagreement between parts, a disagreement in perception. So, and this is why you can basically conjure up a world or conjure up an idea for political authority in the way that she does. So she says, what, said the Empress, can any mortal be a creator? Yes, answered the spirits, for every human creature can create an immaterial world fully inhabited by immaterial creatures, a populace of immaterial subjects. He may create a world of what fashion and government he will. He may alter the world as he pleases, or change it from a natural world to an artificial. He may make a world of ideas, a world of atoms, a world of lights, or whatever his fancy leads him. So the Duchess that this Empress will summon from the real world to be her aid in transforming, going back and transforming the old world, is convinced now by the Empress's ideas. And she begins to, you know, think the world that she somehow wants to recreate. And she begins to assess these various doctrines. And she dismisses ancient philosophy. She dismisses the Pythagorean view, the Platonic view, the Aristotelian view, and then decides to try the opinions of the moderns. Descartes, she says, dizzies her imagination, makes her swoon. Hobbes causes a pain in her head from all the forces of friction, she says. Finally, code 7, she was resolved to make a world of her own invention, one composed of sensitive, rational, self-moving matter. This world was composed only of the rational, which is the subtlest and purest degree of matter. So the fantasy of animate self-willing matter governed by rational and sensitive motions in the blazing world is somehow similar to the fantasy of virtuous subjects who fully believe in the legitimacy of the power of the monarch and who self-move themselves to submit to monarchical authority willingly and through love and not fear, through agreement and not dissent, through that. So if scientific discovery allowed the figures we have been looking at in the course until now to question the grounds of political authority, Cavendish's response was a fantasy that she constructs of the real world, one in which a paradisical monarchy can take root. So she wants us to see this alternative planet, she says, as the very paradise from which Adam had fled and of which the Empress was now luckily the Empress of. The Empress is the new Eve, freed by the scientific discoveries of the age, who, having acquired this knowledge, will now extend it to governance, to govern paradise alone. So, of course, the question, you know, I'm done, it's almost there, the question that Cavendish leaves us with is if monarchical paradise, or this kind of the reinstitution of sovereignty, can only be recuperated through this crazy, absurd idea of rational self-moving matter, rational self-moving subjects who lovingly submit to authority, then this means all social strife, all social conflict is reduced to differences in perception. Basically, differences in perception, not in real political dissent. So we can clearly see how with Cavendish, early liberal thought needed to maintain a closed economy of motion and change, a form of liberal mechanics that funneled the supernatural, although this kind of, it's an, you know, a somewhat atheistic view, but still funnels the supernatural back into nature. So what Cavendish's fantasy tale leaves us with is a realization somewhat that failures to change the world, which is what she really wanted, might actually have to do with how we understand it. Okay, so thank you. Yeah.